so we continue our discussion of deadlocks. So today we will review what we said on what we have learned on deadlock avoidance. Then we will focus on deadlock detection. So most of the lecture is going to be on deadlock detection. Okay. So last time we looked at this pseudocode for the safe sequence, for finding a safe sequence. And in this code, you know, the idea here is to, you have a number of processes, and your objective is to find a safe sequence, an ordering, a linear ordering of the processes in which the needs of a process can be satisfied by what's available in the system plus what will get released by the processes that appear before it in the sequence. And this is the loop that goes through the processes and detects a process whose needs can be satisfied. And the detection is done by comparing the need I with work. Now, this is something that probably wasn't clear last time. Need I. What is need I? Or need sub I? What's that that we are comparing with work?
Yes. Isn't it the current need of the process?
The current need of the process. Yeah, so what is need I? Is it a single number?
I think it's the vector.
Yeah, it's a vector. So basically need I, you have this need matrix. And in a need matrix, you have a row for each process. So process one, process two, process I, through process N. Well, the last process number is N. And you have resources, one, two, through N. And need I is the row that corresponds to process I. So this is need I. So it's a row which is a vector of size M, that is being compared with another vector of size M, which is availability, for each resource. So this operation here, the underlying implementation of this is a vector operation that is, you know, that can probably be implemented by a loop, by writing a loop that goes through the n different resources and comparing. And in order for the needs of a process to be satisfied, this condition must be true for every element in this vector. So for comparing all the numbers here with the numbers in availability, and work is just an updated version of available. So available is what we have initially available, and work is an updated version of available that we update by adding the allocation of the process, of every process that we select in the safe sequence. Okay? And this is another vector operation of that takes M. So this line is actually M operations. So M is the number of resources. N is the number of processes. And that's why this algorithm is, what did we say the running time of this algorithm is?
N squared M.
Yeah, N squared M. Okay, so can you remind us where the N squared comes from and where the M comes from?
The M is the work equals work plus allocation, and then the And then the two ends are the while not done, because you have to go through each one, and then the for loop.
Yeah, exactly. So we have these four loops. We have two loops. It's a doubly nested loop. This while loop, each iteration of the loop will find a process to put in the safe sequence. Now the search for that process, to search for a process, we go down the list of processes. And we find a process that has not been finished. Okay. So in the worst case, this is N, and in the worst case, this is M. Okay. If we think about the average case, now this internal loop here, the for loop, will it ever be possible to execute this loop, execute this inner loop N times for every iteration of the while loop? Will it be possible for this, the inner loop, to be executed n times for every iteration of the outer loop?
Each time you finish a process, it's no longer a candidate for...
It's no longer a candidate, yeah. So it's whenever you finish a process, it's not a candidate, but you'll have to go through it and check if it's a candidate or not. So you still have to go through it. But you will always, you will always find, if there is a safe sequence, if a safe sequence exists, each time you will find a process. So even if in the last time, in the last iteration, so you have P1, P2, P3 through Pn. If in your first iteration of the while loop, this was the, all of these were not ready, their needs cannot be satisfied. This is the only process whose needs can be satisfied. This is the worst case scenario. But then in the next iteration, if a safe sequence exists, then you will find something before Pn whose needs can be satisfied, if a safe sequence exists. So if a safe sequence exists, you're going to find something before Pn, because Pn is done now. Okay? So you'll find something before. Of course, if a safe sequence doesn't exist, then you will go through all of them. You'll have to go through all of them in order to determine that a safe sequence doesn't exist. Okay, but in those iterations where you find a process, it's impossible for the process that you find to always be the last process, right? Because the last process, a process is finished only once. Okay, so in summary, it would be impossible for this loop to get executed n times every time we do the while loop. So we would expect it on average to be executed n over 2 times. But asymptotically, this will not make a difference, because n over 2 is O of n. So asymptotically, this will still be an n squared algorithm. Okay, any questions? Okay. Now this is the higher level algorithm that invokes the previous algorithm. So this is the lower level algorithm that finds a safe sequence. This algorithm, the safe sequence finding algorithm, is invoked by the higher level algorithm, and the higher level algorithm is invoked whenever a process makes a request. Whenever a process makes a request, we pretend that we have made this request, or that we have satisfied this request. First, we check if the request is less than or equal to the need of that process or not. What are we checking for here? We check if the request is less than or equal to the need. What does this checking mean?
Making sure it's not requesting more than it actually needs.
Okay, what would that mean? If this check fails, If the request is not less than or equal to the need, what would that mean?
That the that it's exceeded what it's needed, and that would make everything that we've done up to that point invalid, because now it's requiring more than what it said it needed.
Yeah, exactly. More than what it said. So that's the key. More than what it said. What it said is the max that it declared. So our analysis is based on this max that a process has declared. So it declared its maximum need from each from each resource. And if it at some point requests something that exceeds the need, then the maximum that it declared was incorrect. And all the analysis will be incorrect, because the analysis is based on the correctness of these maximum needs of the processes. And this need here, this is the projected need or the future need. So remember, need equals max minus allocation. Need equals max minus allocation. So this is the projected need. This is what the process currently has. This is what the process said will be its maximum need. And based on the maximum need and what it currently has, we calculate what it will be or may be requesting in the future. And if it ever requests something that exceeds the need that we have calculated here, then this maximum must have been wrong. So this is what this check means. The other check is checking if the request is within what's available. Because clearly, if it's requesting something that exceeds what's available, then obviously we will not find a safe sequence. We cannot satisfy this request. Okay. Now, if both of these pass, we will pretend that we have satisfied the request by subtracting what it's requesting from what is available, and by adding the request to its current allocation. So what is available in the system is going to be what is currently available minus the request. The current allocation of the process will be, we will add the request to the current allocation. We will subtract the request from the need, because it will not need it in the future. And then we invoke the algorithm that looks for a safe sequence. And based on that, if there is a safe sequence, we grant the request and we commit. We commit the change. If we can't find a safe sequence, we deny the request and we roll back, we go back to the previous state. So the philosophy of this deadlock avoidance algorithm is to stay in a safe state and to deny any request that will put the system in an unsafe state. And so do you think that this algorithm is a practical algorithm? You know, what do you think about the practicality of this algorithm?
Not likely.
So it's not. Why not?
Because you're trying to predict based on information that you wouldn't have in a real situation.
Exactly. So in the real world, processes. Basically these maxima. It's practically impossible to know these maxima. Maximum needs of the process. So requiring each process to declare its maximum resource requirements and doing the analysis based on that, it's just impractical. And that's why operating systems do not implement this. Okay, real operating systems do not implement this. We study this because it's theoretically interesting. From a theoretical point of view, but it's also, from a practical point of view, it's important to understand you know, deadlocks and how they happen, because in the real world, it's the responsibility of the application programmer to make sure that their processes, their multi-threaded or multi-process application doesn't run into a deadlock. So when you design a multi-threaded or a multi-process application, it's your responsibility as an application programmer to analyze your program and to make sure that deadlocks will not happen. Okay, and deadlocks do happen, and they have happened to me in my practice. So you have to be aware of them, and it's good to have the you know, the ability to analyze deadlocks, and so that you can avoid them by designing your application properly.